In this Q&A video, we'll be answering the question, do I need pen fault protection on an EV charger connected to a three-phase supply? This question relates to the recent video that Gary and Gordon made on a really innovative EV charge point from Zaptec, which cleverly juggles the charging of multiple electric vehicles from several charge points using just one reasonably sized supply. It's a great looking and very intelligent solution to the tricky issue of charging multiple vehicles, so do go and check that video out for a full teardown and description. You may have noticed in that video and others that we did in fact install pen fault protection to our Zaptec charge point, so why did we do that? We've described pen faults in some detail on our channel and as part of our training videos, so by now hopefully you're familiar with the dangers involved in a pen fault. If the combined neutral and earth cable supplying a house becomes disconnected outside the building, the current inside the installation will try to find ways back to the transformer supplying the property. And if someone's really unlucky and standing on the actual earth we walk around on, or holding onto a metallic pipe buried in the ground, it could flow through them. Inside the property, we can resolve this problem by connecting all the exposed conductive parts of a circuit to the extraneous conductive parts via the main earthing terminal, which means that all the metalwork is at the same potential and a person is much less likely to get a shock to the literal earth that we walk around on. An EV charging up outside presents an extra hazard, because if a pen fault has occurred and the bodywork of the car has become live, then it's possible someone touching the car will have a reasonable connection to the literal earth and they will receive a potentially fatal electric shock. Because of this, regulation 722.411.4.1 tells us that a PME earthing facility shall not be used as the means of earthing for the protective conductor contact of a charging point located outdoors, or that might reasonably be expected to be used to charge a vehicle located outdoors, unless one of the following methods is used. So you can't connect the earth terminal on an EV charge point to the PME terminal of a TNC-S supply if the EV connected to it is likely to charge up outside. However, you can do this if you use one of the options listed in that reg, and we've discussed these at length in other content. However, one of those options is no longer available to us. As you can see here, it's been deleted by Amendment 2 of the 18th edition. What was it, and why has it been removed? Well, we can look back to the first amendment to the 18th edition, which was the one that had no physical release, if you remember, just the digital version that you could pay extra to print out. And that first indent is present there, and it states that the charging point forms part of a three-phase installation that also supplies loads other than for electric vehicle charging, and because of the characteristics of the load of the installation, the maximum voltage between the main earthing terminal of the installation and earth in the event of an open circuit fault in the pen conductor of the low voltage network supplying the installation does not exceed 70 volts RMS. So at first glance, that seems pretty acceptable, that if we're connecting an EV charge point to an installation fed by a three-phase supply, that we can connect the protective conductor to the PME and all will be well. So why was that acceptable? Well, remember, the problem occurs when the combined neutral and earth conductor into the installation loses its connection and the current is looking for that route out, meaning that the voltage between the bodywork of the car and the literal earth was likely to go well above 70 volts, which is the point at which the voltage would become potentially lethal in this situation. In a three-phase system though, the current in the neutral works a little differently. In fact, if the loads on each phase are perfectly balanced or equal, then the current in the neutral would be zero. And you can actually do without the neutral connection entirely. So if a pen fault occurred on a perfectly balanced three-phase system, then there'd be no neutral current trying to find its way back to the transformer, and the voltage between the bodywork of the car and the actual earth we walk around on will be effectively zero. However, that brings us nicely on to the end of the old indent we just read, because it gives this little caveat. Because of the characteristics of the load of the installation, the maximum voltage between the main earthing terminal of the installation and earth in the event of an open circuit fault in the pen conductor of the low voltage network supplying the installation does not exceed 70 volts RMS. So why would that happen? Well, we said that in a balanced load, the current trying to flow down the neutral and therefore the voltage to earth would be zero. However, the problem occurs when the loads become unbalanced and you have different amounts of current flowing through the three line conductors. When this happens, some current will flow down the neutral and the voltage between the bodywork of the car and the earth will rise. And if it rises above 70 volts, then anyone touching the car could be in serious danger if a pen fault then occurs. So how do we know at what point that voltage would rise to 70 volts? Well, note one to that indent tells us that Annex 722, item A722.2, gives some information relating to 1. So turning to that reference, we find that where triple harmonics can be neglected, condition 1 of regulation 722.411.4.1, which is the reg we're reading at the moment, may be assumed to apply where the following condition is met. This formula should take account of Cmax in line with PD CLC TR 50480. There then follows a rather intimidating looking formula. Im times UO times Cmax over IL1 plus IL2 plus IL3 is less than or equal to 70 volts. The formula is actually pretty simple. It's just Ohm's law and the power formula all jumbled up together. On the top line, Im is the current in the neutral, which can be found by applying the rather scary formula in A722.1, and is rather dear to my heart as someone who loved teaching electrical science. Then we've got UO, which is the nominal voltage to earth in the system, so 230 volts, and Cmax is just a way of adjusting the voltage to allow for variations to the supply voltage. These are multiplied together, and then the division part on the bottom row is just the three currents in the three phases added together. So all this is doing is indicating that the maths on the left should be less than or equal to 70 volts. So the annex is saying that if that formula is true and the maths is less than or equal to 70 volts when a pen fault occurs, then the installation will be safe. Importantly, however, it's also saying that the opposite is the case, and if the maths on the left is more than 70 volts, then the installation will not be safe. Now, obviously, that could be a little bit tricky to calculate, so I've volleyed all of that maths into a graphing program, and we can see what happens as the currents change. So here we've got the neutral current formula that inputs into the less than or equal to formula here, and down here we've got sliders to adjust the currents in the three phases. I've set a line here just to show when things get dangerous, and a red line here indicates what the voltage will be between the body of the car and the literal earth as the currents change. So let's just bear in mind that an unbalanced three-phase system in itself is not great, but it's not dangerous. What we're showing here is what happens when the system isn't balanced and a pen fault occurs. So first of all, we've got all three phases perfectly the same. The system is balanced, and you can see the red line is down at zero, and the system is safe should a pen fault occur. And you can see it doesn't matter what those values are, as long as they're the same, we've got 0 volts between the body of the car and the literal earth. And that makes sense, because if all the currents are the same in each phase, then the neutral current is zero, and when you multiply and divide zero, the answer is always zero. However, look what happens when we start to unbalance the system. Let's load up the current in L1 a bit, because that's what tends to happen in the real world. Can you see there the voltage between the body of the car and the literal earth is now going up, until if the difference in the phases gets big enough, it goes over that threshold value of 70 volts, and suddenly the person touching the car and standing on the ground has 70 volts across them and is in serious danger. And actually, this danger is magnified at lower currents. If we set them all low, down at say 5 amps, it only takes a very small amount of difference for the voltage to go over 70 volts. So as you can see, it's actually quite tricky to keep that voltage down below 70 volts unless the phases in an installation are reasonably balanced. And so unless you know the currents in a three-phase installation can be kept at a level where they won't tip the voltage over that value in the event of a pen fault, then you can't apply indent 1 of regulation 722.411.4.1. It may be possible in some installations where you know you'll have balanced three-phase loads in place all the time, but it's very difficult to guarantee. And that, I believe, is the reason that if we look at that same regulation in the second amendment to the 18th edition, you'll notice that this option in indent 1 has been deleted, which means that from the 27th of September 2022 onwards, you'll no longer be able to rely on the charge point being connected to a three-phase system as protection enough, and you'll need to carry out one of the options from indents 2 to 5 to provide pen fault protection. So there we go. That's why I believe that indent has been removed, and also why you will need to provide some kind of pen fault protection to an EV charge point installed on a three-phase system with a PME terminal. But as always, we want to hear from you. Were you aware that load balancing was critical in keeping to the 70 volt limit in a three-phase system? Do you think it was the right decision to remove that option? Whatever your thoughts and questions, please leave them in the comments section below, and as always, thank you very much for watching.